Today we're going to be studying out Luke chapter 23. The title of our lesson is The Guilty of Golgotha. Golgotha, of course, is Aramaic for the place of the skull. It's the name of the hill just north of Jerusalem that literally, when you look out upon it, has the form and the shape of a skull. And all cultures, and we remember that Luke's gospel is generally speaking for the Gentiles, but all cultures look upon the skull as an emblem of foreboding and an emblem of death and the curse of God. In Luke chapter 22, remember, the last time we were together, Jesus is betrayed by a kiss by one of the 12, Judas. The disciples scatter. The trial begins at the house of the high priest, Caiaphas. By daybreak, Jesus is brought before the Sanhedrin, where, as we talked about, he made his good confession. After the trial of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish leadership is now absolutely convinced that they've been right all along about Jesus. That indeed, he's a troublemaker. And he needs to be put to death. And yet, to be able to do this, because they were under Roman occupation, in order to issue the death sentence, Jesus had to be brought before the Roman authorities. Let's now begin in chapter 23. Then the whole assembly arose, the Sanhedrin, and led him off to Pilate. Pilate, of course, is the Roman procurator of all of Judea. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes the payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Christ, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Yes, it's as you say," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis of a charge against this man." We're going to be looking about through this scriptures all of the faces around the cross. And right here, we see that the Sanhedrin has brought Jesus to Pilate for Pilate to pronounce the death sentence on him. There were three charges against them. Number one, he subverted the nation. Number two, he opposed the taxes payment to Caesar. And number three, he claimed to be Christ, a king. As for subverting a nation, we understand that Jesus was not about subverting the nation. On the other hand, he opposed the Jewish leadership. Number two, from Luke 20, we know that he did not oppose the payment of taxes to Caesar. As a matter of fact, he says, "Render unto Caesar what is Caesar, and to God, what is God?" And finally, his claim to be Christ the King, well, of course, the Jews were trying to trump this on up as Jesus was trying to lead a separatist movement. But even Pilate understood that he offered no physical threat to Rome. And so we see right here a falsehood, a half-truth, and a truth that has been twisted. And bottom line now, Luke is trying to communicate to his Gentile non-believing audience, this Jesus is unjustly being charged by the Jewish leadership. But Pilate says in verse 4, "I find no basis of a charge against him." He is innocent. Over and over again, we're going to see that Luke communicates this message in verse 5. But the Jewish leadership insisted, "He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here." You know, for a lot of people, if something is controversial, then there must be something wrong. And yet it's just the opposite in the kingdom of God. We know that if something is controversial, there must be something right. A lot of people draw back from being in a controversial church going, "Oh, I wonder what's wrong." And yet really the question needs to be, if you're not in a controversial church, you need to be asking, what is wrong right here? Jesus was controversial, and his church is going to be controversial when they preach the message of Jesus. Are you with me here, church?
Yes.
Verse 6. On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at the time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he'd been waiting to see him. From what he'd heard about him, he'd hoped to see him perform some miracle. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they'd been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests and the rulers of the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I've examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing deserving death. He is innocent. Therefore, I'll punish him and then release him." You know, right here, we find that Pilate is trying to be a shifty, shrewd politician and get out from the responsibility of making a decision about Jesus right here. And he goes, "Oh, wow, you're from Galilee? Well, then you're under Herod's jurisdiction." So he says, "Okay, I'll let Herod take the blame right here." Well, Herod was all fired up. "Oh, man, I've been waiting to see this Jesus. I've heard all about these miracles." But the Bible says that Jesus wouldn't even answer him back. And so he's mocked by those that charge him and even by the soldiers that are with Herod. And they send him back to Pilate. But Pilate notes, he says, "Listen, I see this man as innocent, and even Herod sees this man as innocent." Verse 18, "With one voice they cried out, 'Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us!' Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appeared to them again, but they kept shouting, 'Crucify him! Crucify him!' For the third time he spoke to them, 'Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. He's innocent. Therefore, I'll have him punished, then release him.' But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their wills." Right here, we first look at the Jewish leadership, and they falsely condemn an innocent man, saying they believe in the one true God. They stand guilty before God. Pilate, representing the civil leadership of the Romans, tries to get rid of Jesus, tries to avoid making a decision about him. As a matter of fact, Matthew even notes that he comes out before the people and he says, "Hey, I'm washing my hands of this man's blood. Let his blood be on your heads." But we find out that he is a weak leader because he is swayed by the crowds. And so he stands guilty for not taking a stand for justice and truth, that for which he was supposed to be the governor of. We find Herod, king of the Jews of Judea. He wanted a miracle. He wanted to be entertained by this preacher. And how many people go to church on Sunday morning wanting to be entertained by their preacher or by a great music program, and then be able to leave and live the life of sin that they just heard preached against? Sad to say, with Herod, Jesus said no word. Herod's hypocrisy had silenced the very voice of God. Over and over, we see that Luke is stressing Jesus' innocence and the injustice of the moment. This is for us to learn from. as I shared earlier this morning, our brother, our new brother, Michael Olney, over there in Nairobi, Kenya, he's been baptizing people. He was a denominational preacher. He took a stand for the truth. He lost his house, lost his pay, but he's been preaching the word of God and baptizing people, not only in Kenya, but in Tanzania. But even he was hit by his faith just recently, just a couple weeks ago, when his father-in-law, some 80 years old, was robbed and beaten and left for dead. He had no money. He was taken to the hospital. The hospital wouldn't do anything. He was crying on out. And then our brother, Eric O'Clint, who's in Sweden and sometimes in Tallinn, Estonia, heard about Michael's dilemma and mailed to him several hundred dollars so his father-in-law can be healed there in the hospital. The father-in-law was so grateful for the fellowship that would help him out beyond Nairobi that his father-in-law studied the Bible and was just baptized a couple of days ago. I told Michael, I said, now you understand. You understand a great truth, that the very plan of God is the plan of Satan. But you need to be able to see the hand of God moving. Satan was trying to destroy Jesus right here. God was trying to bring the salvation of the world. In one and the same act, they were coming on down. But a decision had to be made. You know, I think it's a very interesting verse, verse 12, don't you? That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Well, that probably shouldn't surprise us. The Jewish civil leader and the Roman civil leader. But there actually is a little bit of history here. Pilate had wanted to put, in his mind, these incredible shields into the temple of God. They were inscribed with Gentile names of the people that they were dedicated to. Herod and the Jewish people were so upset that anything Gentile would come into the temple. Because remember, they've been working on the temple for 30 years. Remember the renovation that's gone on? How can it be desecrated with things of the Gentile? They were so upset, they sent word to Tiberius Caesar. Tiberius Caesar sends word back to Pilate and loosely translated it went, you idiot, what the heck are you doing out there? Put the shields into the pagan temple there in Caesarea. And this is what they did. But there was obviously a lot of angst between the two. And yet, very interestingly, the scriptures very clearly say that at this juncture, these two former enemies now become friends. Isn't it interesting that with a common cause, people are united? Be it bad or be it good. Isn't it interesting, even in our fellowship, that the strongest of the disciples are drawn to the strong disciples, and those with qualms and quiet reservations are drawn to each other? It is an amazing thing. You know, this week I had to jump into a couple of situations where two very, I would consider them strong disciples, were not getting along. Or as we would say in our vernacular, they weren't clicking. Let's turn to Luke chapter 6. Jesus has some words about not clicking with each other. I mean, you got to admit, if Herod and Pilate can click, there's hope for all of us, is there not? Verse 27. But I tell you who hear me, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. Verse 32. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. You know, for us to be drawn to those people that are like us in the fellowship is no kudos to us. The glory of the body of Christ is that we deeply love from the heart those that we don't click with. This is what he says right here. He says, even the people in the world love those people that love them. But in the church, it's different. We love people that are different than us. This is the glory of the church. I mean, it's awesome in this room. We have black, white, Asian, Latin, and then some colors in between sometimes. And yet the world, there's a Latin church, there's a white church, there's a black church. But the beauty of it is that we're all together. Are you with me right here? I mean, we've got old people and we've got young people and we're together. Are you with me right here? You know, I'll never forget, a couple years ago, we were having lunch with a dear couple over in Phoenix, Chris and Sonia Klopek. And we were just talking, and they were the number two couple there under the Sullivans, Matt and Helen Sullivan, who are now down in Santiago. And we were just talking and just getting on into it a little bit. And say, I said, well, Chris, how's it going with Matt? He says, oh, bro, it is awesome. Matt and I, best friends. Well, Sonia, how's it going with Helen? Well, Helen is a very committed Christian. And I see us to be good friends. I said, sis, there's a little thing here. Well, Kip, let's just be honest. We're so different. And you know, that's the truth. For some of you know Sonia, I mean, she is this strikingly beautiful former model, you know. She dresses to the nines, you know. I mean, just every little hair is in place, you know. Helen is this brainiac from Stanford, you know, that for a good time goes out and runs 10 miles. And so, I mean, true, they were just very, very different. And yet, for the glory of God to be there, they had to learn to love one another from the heart. Why? Instead of looking at the differences that are worldly, we need to center in on we have what's most important in common. We have a relationship with God in common, and we have our salvation, and we have our purpose in common. You see, when you have your relationship with God in common, when you have your purpose in common, it doesn't make any difference how different you may be. You can be best friends in the Lord. Are you with me right here? See, we need to have this kind of conviction. And in this sense, Herod and Pilate should inspire you. Let's move on to some more faces around the cross. Back to Luke 23. Verse 26. As they led Jesus away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on the way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made it carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including the women, who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children, for the time will come when you will say, blessed are the barren women, the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed. Then they will say to the mountains, fall on us, and the hills, cover us. For if men do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry? You know, right here, we find that Jesus had been so beaten up by the flogging, so overwhelmed emotionally by all that he had been through, that when asked to carry what's called the patibulum up to Golgotha, to where he'd be crucified, he couldn't make it. Different than a lot of motion pictures portray. Most likely, Jesus had a large pole strapped to his back, to which his hands were tied with ropes. It may have varied from 50 to 100 pounds. And he literally had to carry this up the hill, but he collapsed under the weight of what's called the patibulum. Because you see, when he would get to the cross, they literally would take forklifts, that's where expression comes from, and on two sides they'd prop up the man and put him on top of the main stake that was permanent up there on the hill. Yes, they would have nailed his hands previous to that. But sometimes they didn't even nail the feet at all because he would just dangle there and more quickly suffocate to death. Because the whole purpose of crucifixion was to humiliate the person, but to send a message to the people. Don't you dare do this or this will happen to you. Well, as Jesus was on his way to Golgotha, he collapses. And the Bible says they seize a guy named Simon from Cyrene. Now, Cyrene's in northern Africa. And so he was a Jew that had traveled on in from the Passover. And they just basically conscripted him. Say, hey, you help out. And so he begins to carry the cross of Jesus. Well, you know, we talked about it last week. To have your name in the Bible, you've got to have done something very, very, very bad. Or totally awesome. Let's see who this guy Simon of Cyrene is. Let's do a little cross-referencing right here. Mark chapter 15. I mean, after all, there are very few names in the Bible, really. Verse 21. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Wow. Simon's mentioned right here, and now his two boys are mentioned, Alexander and Rufus. Well, what most likely had happened? Simon became a disciple. Alexander and Rufus came a disciple. But what happened to them? Turn to Romans chapter 16. Paul, of course, is writing many, many, many years later. He's writing to the disciples there in Rome. And we simply find this notation in verse 13. It's awesome. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother, who has become a mother to me too. This is Paul writing it. Rufus becomes one of the powerful leaders in the church at Rome. And his mom, the wife of Simon of Cyrene, becomes a spiritual mom in the faith to none other than the Apostle Paul himself. Is that cranking or not? You know, I was very blessed this Thursday to be pulled in by Javier Ochoa to the Bible study of Eddie Alvarado. Now, if you don't know Eddie, Eddie's a good-looking kid, about 6'1", football player, quarterback. Looks like he's got all going for him. You know what I'm talking about? A little bit different than most of us. And Javier said, you know, bro, he wants to get together to study the Bible, but, you know, he's right there wanting to make a decision, but there's one cost. His girlfriend. And as, you know, most of us have been there, the relationship was not right with the Lord. And so we get together and we had a nice meal and then it was time to talk. You know how that is? You have the nice meal and... Are you done? Oh, yay. It's time to talk. And you know, Eddie's a straightforward guy. He's an incredible kid. He goes, well, bro, do I really have to give up my girlfriend? I mean, she really is going at it. She's studying the Bible. She's really awesome. Yeah. I go, you know, Eddie, let's go over to Mark chapter 10, shall we? So we moseyed on over to Mark 10. Why don't you mosey on over there for a moment here? This, of course, is the account of the rich young ruler. The rich young ruler was a very moral young man, and he comes up to Jesus. What must I do to be saved? The Bible says in verse 21, Jesus looked at him and loved him. He says, you lack one thing. Go sell everything you have and give it to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. I says, Eddie, what's it say? He says, you have to give up everything. I says, exactly. I said, but he goes, but what about my girlfriend? Eddie, everything. Look what happens at the end of the account. It says in verse 28, Peter said to Jesus, Lord, we've left everything to follow you. So Peter understood you had to leave everything. And then I said, Eddie, now watch this. I tell you the truth, Jesus replied. No one who's left home or brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers, children, fields, or girlfriends for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, home, brothers, sisters, children, fields, and with them persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life. It's clear. If you're going to be a disciple of Jesus, Peter understood. You had to give up everything. Or as the Pearl of Great Price talks about, you got to sell everything. You got to be a sold out disciple. I said this, you know, we're not going to have a real long Bible study here tonight. Eddie? Really, just a couple verses will get you ready. Let's look at one more verse. So I said, let's go to Mark 3. I said, this deals with family. Frankly, Jesus' physical family thought that he was out of his mind. And we read this in verse 31. Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, your mother and brothers are outside looking for you. Who are my mother and my brothers, he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. I said, Eddie, you know, physical family is very important. And you got a heck of a mom in Jackie. And you got a great dad. His dad is with us. They drove all the way all night from Arizona to be here for the baptism. I said, but you know, the Bible teaches right here, it's really all you need to understand. You got to give up everything for Jesus. And then what is it all about? Jesus, hey, who is my real family? Who is my mother, my brother, my sister? Well, those who obey the word of God. Notice who he left out right here. His father. Why? Because that's what life is all about. When you become a disciple, it's getting a relationship with God as your father. See, Eddie, if you understand you give up everything, you get a relationship with God as your father, and then you have the church as your family, you're good to go. Then we talked a little bit about a couple of his friends that were studying. And I don't know why, but Javier had a couple questions. And he says, you know, I don't know. I said, you know, he's got this kid's struggling with this, this kid's struggling with this. And he says, what do I need to do? And he goes, they need to give up everything. I said, that's awesome, Eddie. That's great. That's helping out Javier right here. You know, the exciting thing is, Eddie's getting baptized this morning. Amen. You know, we need to understand that in the Bible, it's not a matter of just simply information transfer. It would not have been good for me to sit down with Eddie and say, okay, dude, just read this. This is the information you know. You need to, you know, give up everything, and the church, God is your father, and the church is your family. There, you have that information now. No. The Bible says that in order to be baptized, people must be taught to obey the teachings. See, a lot of churches want to teach the teachings. That's not sufficient. You guys that are parents, you know the difference between teaching your kid what to do and teaching obedience about what to do. If you tell the kid, hey, make your bed, clean your room, you're going to get zero results. You teach obedience to make your bed and clean your room, you're going to get some results. You know what I'm talking about right here? You see, it's very important. See, a lot of people then look at discipling and say, oh, it's controlling. No, it's not controlling. But we are trying to change people's lives. And we're not trying to obey us. I mean, who are we? Fellow derelicts. I mean, yep, after all, I mean, Eddie was discipling Javier already. He wasn't even baptized and everything. And but we need to understand that in order to be baptized, A person's heart has to be right. They have to be taught obedience to the word of God. They have to be made into a disciple. Are you with me right here? So, attending church, for a lot of people, that's optional. It's up to, No. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. You need to attend church Sunday, Wednesday, devotional, Bible talk, first principles. And you know, there are times, maybe a flat tire, maybe some challenges in your health or whatever. And that's why when someone misses, we don't jump on them. But out of concern, like we would for a child that misses dinner, we say, hey, what's up? How many people have gone unloved because they missed church and then just began to drift away because no one really cared enough to call? See, that's what the family of God's about. Now, is that uncomfortable sometimes? You betcha. But who are the people that have changed your life the most? The ones that have made you the most uncomfortable. You say, well, what about Eddie's girlfriend? Oh, Nikki? Oh, she's going to be baptized real soon. Amen, guys. I mean, it's all good. See, when you put the Lord first, the Lord gives it all back to you. Amen, guys. Let's keep moving on right here. Back to Luke. We see right here that now Simon's got the cross. He's following Jesus. In a very real way, that's what we do. We follow Jesus with his cross. Same commitment as Jesus. Not your cross, his cross. But you know, all the commitment in the world doesn't save you. See, Simon of Cyrene was a sinner. He was guilty. Behind him were a large group of women crying and weeping. And Jesus said, hey, daughters of Jerusalem, don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. Because judgment is coming. And he's referring to, of course, 70 AD. And he references a couple scriptures and he says, hey, some of you are going to be said, it's better for me never to have given birth. Well, to be given birth in a Jewish mindset is to be blessed by God. He's going to say, you're going to feel blessed if you haven't given birth. You're going to want a quick death. You want people. It's going to be so terrible when 70 AD comes. He says, as a matter of fact, for if men do these things when the tree is green, he says, if they're unjustly doing this to me now, when there's still a little bit of life left in the Jewish nation, what's going to happen when the whole tree is dead? And you saw the wildfires of Malibu, when everything was dead on the hills and just rapidly spread. And of course, the decimation in 70 AD. Jerusalem's population, 1.2 million. 1.1 million were slaughtered. Men, women, and babies. The other 100,000 taken into slavery. Jesus' words are more than true. Judgment had come upon all of the Jewish nation because they were guilty. Let's move on. Verse 32. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, Golgotha, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on the right and one on the left. She said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. Of course, that's in reference to the scriptures being fulfilled in Psalm 22:18. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. I mean, the Jewish leadership had followed him up to Golgotha. They're sneering at him. They said, he saved others. Let him save himself if he's the Christ of God, the chosen one. I mean, that's pretty ironic because in the end, he is going to save others. The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, if you're the king of the Jews, save yourself. There was a written notice above him which read, this is the king of the Jews. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us. I mean, isn't it amazing? The Jewish leadership is mocking Jesus. Then the Romans begin to do exactly the same things. Then even the criminal who's being killed for his sins uses the very same words. How we follow the crowd. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God?
No.
Since you're under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. A criminal pronounces Jesus innocent. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, I tell you the truth. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. You know, sadly, in this very moving scripture has been twisted by the denominational world and offered as a false way to receive salvation. We, of course, understand from Acts 2:38, and we know the Bible does not contradict itself, that in order to be saved, biblically speaking, you have to have faith in Jesus Christ. You have to repent of your sins. You have to make Jesus the Lord of your life by being a disciple, and then you're baptized, you're immersed to have your sins forgiven and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, you know, I come from a background of believing very sincerely that the way to be saved was to say a prayer. Pray Jesus into your heart and you'll be saved. I sincerely believed it. I even changed my life believing it. And so when I was confronted that saying a prayer was not the way the Bible taught about how to be saved, I was ticked off. Who the heck are you to tell me I am guilty? It's very interesting. If you follow the scriptures clearly, you understand that Jesus had the power to forgive the sins of anyone he forgave sins of. Whether it be the woman that came to him and wept on his feet, or whether it be the paralytic that was lowered through the roof in Mark 2. Jesus had the power to forgive sins because he was going to die for those sins. Secondly, turn to Romans chapter 6. In Romans 6, we find out what baptism's all about. Paul is writing. He says, he's talking to all the Christians at Rome in verse 2. We died to sin. How can we live it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We are therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from death to the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. He says, before we were baptized, we had the old life. After we were baptized, we had the new life. Why? Because we were baptized into Christ. We were baptized into his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Are you with me right here, guys? Now, that's essential because what ultimately forgives us of our sins? It's the blood of Jesus, does it not? Romans chapter 3, verses 23 through 25. Well, where did Jesus shed his blood? When he died. So when you share in his death, you contact his blood, and you come out of the water with all of your sins forgiven, resurrected to newness of life. Does that fire you on up or not? See, we need to understand the glory of that. It was really cool. Just about 10 days ago, we had a baptism late Wednesday night after First Principles, and Trudy Mays was baptized at Manhattan Beach. And it was, a lot of the sisters have been studying with her and everything, and it was about 11 o'clock at night, and the waves were a little bit bigger than normal down there. But nonetheless, after she'd made her good confession, Alan took her along with Liliana into the water. And we saw them lowering Trudy on down in the water, and the next thing we know, this whole wave sweeps over them. We see, and all of a sudden, Alan and Trudy kind of emerge out of the water, and then we go, where's Liliana? 20 feet over this way, Liliana was Owen. One of the little kids goes, well, does that mean we had three baptisms? You know, baptism is something when you see it, you know, that's right. That's right. Getting back to the criminal in this passage in Luke 23. Have you ever looked at someone, perhaps homeless, perhaps addicted to alcohol, perhaps suicidal, perhaps seemingly what we would judge as one of the dregs of society, which indeed what this criminal was? And you don't even bother sharing your faith Because you really don't think they can change. You know, last Sunday's going to live in my memory all the way to heaven. The privilege of going out and being at that first service there in New York with the mission team, the Empire City International Christian Church. We had 20 disciples on the team. We had one Quaker who had just moved there. We had six from L.A., and they had 78 in attendance. They had over 50 non-Christians. They set up 40 studies. Is that incredible? The other church that we started on that day in our new movement was in our nation's capital, Washington, D.C. They had 134 in attendance. They had a bunch of disciples come down from Syracuse, and they had 45 non-Christians, a baptism, a restoration, and two place memberships. I mean, God is moving. Are you with me right there? And there were so many incredible visitors there in New York, but there was one that caught my eye. I said, why did it catch your eye? What was the only guy I think that was older than me in the auditorium? And he was much older than me. He turns out to be 78 years old. Wow. About a week before, George Greenman, one of the brothers there, had been out sharing his faith. See, that's what disciples do. And he saw this older gentleman. He goes, man, I've seen this guy somewhere. So he went up to him and he said, hey, you know, I have a Bible study at my home on Thursday. Would you like to come? The guy just started crying. And he says, sir, what's wrong? He says, I just picked up a cloth from the sidewalk that said, a miracle will happen to you today. And he went to George, are you my miracle? Goes to Bible talk, and then George recognizes who it is. It's the guy that stands in front of the strip club a block or so away from George's house. Turns out, this guy is a multimillionaire. He owns the whole building where the strip club is at. He comes in on Sunday just with his cane, sits right down behind us, listens intently. And of course, DJ, you know, DJ crazy, you know, comes up. I think the title of his lesson was, Are You on Broadway? Of course, the whole idea of the Broadway versus the narrow way. I knew I had to explain that to a couple of you guys. And this guy just opens up. He says, you know, I need to get in the narrow way. I've been married 5 times. He says, I wonder if there's someone can help me get in the narrow way. And you know something? I think I need to bring some of the girls to the next service. Amen. You see, that's just how it is. Anybody can be saved. Are you with me right here, guys? But the criminals, they were guilty. But you see, you're never going to appreciate the good news of Jesus until you see the bad news of your life. And this one criminal understood it. Wow. Let's get back to Luke 23. Verse 44. It was now about the sixth hour, which would be noontime. It's now about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. For the sun stopped shining. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what happened, praised God and said, surely this was a righteous man. Oh my goodness, even the Roman centurion that most likely stabbed the spear into Jesus' side said, this man was innocent. Look at the cosmic declaration of darkness on the hill for 3 hours. When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts. Man, they were calling for him to be killed. Now they're beating their breasts, and they go away. But all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching these things. Mark tells us that the crucifixion actually began at 9 a.m., at the third hour. Darkness comes at noontime and lasts for 3 hours. This was not an eclipse. Can you imagine? In the brightness of the Middle Eastern sun, at noontime, there hung Jesus in the middle of two criminals, and darkness comes over the land. I'm going to tell you, that's spooky. That's eerie. The amazing thing right here is at that very moment, the temple, the veil, the curtain of the temple is torn in two, signifying very clearly, remember, he's writing to a Gentile audience, that no longer is this temple God's place to reside, but now God has torn the temple veil and he is going out into all the world, into all peoples. And the Bible says that Jesus' last words were words of faith. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. The centurion saw him as an innocent and righteous man, and rightfully so. And yet, I put before you that at the last moment, that was not true. That Jesus, like everybody else, was guilty there in Golgotha. In the Mark text and the Matthew text, some of the last words of Jesus were, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is Aramaic, and so Luke does not include them. Which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? See, we understand from Scripture that Jesus was the perfect, righteous, innocent Lamb of God. That at that very moment, he took upon himself all the sins of the world, all the sins beforehand, all the sins of the present, and all the sins of the future. Now, you and I know, when we've done something very sinful, you know that feeling that you just hits you, that ugh feeling? That's just one sin, and we've done a lot. Can you imagine being totally righteous and for the first time being hit with everybody's ugh at the same moment? And that separation coming into you, one who you had perfect unity with, God the Father. And then for that moment you go, my God, my God! Why have you forsaken me? The horror. Jesus was guilty. Not because of his sin, because of yours. You know, it's interesting to me that when these people who had called for Christ's death saw the darkness and the way he died and heard the words of this godless centurion, they begin to beat their breasts. They go, oh my God, we have really messed up. They beat their breasts and they leave. But then, look at this. I never caught this before. Verse 49, but all those who knew him, well, who are they? That's the disciples. But Luke couldn't call them disciples anymore. They were just simply the ones that knew him. They were no longer disciples. Even the women that other gospels treat a little bit more soft touch. Luke says, listen. There was nobody close to the cross. Everybody was distant. Everybody was guilty. The death of Jesus changed people who wanted to kill him. I put before you, that's why we have communion. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It's interesting to me that communion does not celebrate the resurrection. Communion celebrates his death. You know the scriptures. He took the bread and broke it, representing the breaking of his body. So today, when you get the cracker, when you break it, that you're not just breaking off a little piece, it's a little bit small. You're breaking his body. That's what that represents. When you drink the red grape juice, that represents his blood that was shed for you. It should shake you up. And so Paul writes in verse 27, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread and drinks the cup. For if anyone eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord, eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. This is the reason you're not doing great spiritually, is you have not focused in on the death of Jesus. How powerful the death of Jesus? It's powerful enough to turn those that didn't believe, to turn those that wanted to crucify him, into people that were beating their breasts in shame. Now, today you may be doing awesome spiritually. You're commended by the Lord. But if you're a disciple and you're not doing awesome spiritually, then you're one of three categories. Weak. Well, we talk a lot about that, frankly. Weak has the connotation of being weak physically or weak emotionally. We talk a fair amount. Falling asleep. Well, we understand that's a euphemism for being dead. Jesus uses this in Revelation chapter 3 with the church of Sardis. He says, you have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. So being asleep means that you can be totally dead, fallen away, and still be coming to church. Now that goes against the theology of a lot of people. Say, I'm coming to church. I'm coming Sunday. I'm coming Wednesday. I'm going through all the months. No, you are flat dead. You're asleep. You've fallen away. You die. You go to hell. What do you need to discern the death of Jesus? But you know, there's a third category we don't use in our vernacular in the church. We use weak. We use fall asleep, but we don't talk about the spiritually sick. What does it mean to be spiritually sick? Well, to be sick is to be unhealed. Therefore, to be sick is to be perpetually wounded. What does it mean to be perpetually wounded? What heals the wounds but forgiveness? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. See, a sick Christian is a bitter and critical Christian who is unhealed from his past sins, be they sins of commission they have done, perpetually drinking alcohol, or be they bitter feelings because another Christian sinned against them. Neither is excused in the eyes of God. And they are sick, and they are to be pitied. And yet as disciples, we are to love and get them to church to take communion. That's when someone misses church, guys, we've got to go take communion to them. It's not a matter of just a quick phone call. Not a matter of, hey, here's some flowers. It's time to get communion to them. The death of Jesus changes the weak, the sick, and the fallen asleep to be sold out disciples of Jesus Christ. Let's close out here. Luke 23. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. They took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb, cut in rock, one to which no one had yet been laid. It was the preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph, and the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared the spices and perfume, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. Well, this dude must be somebody special. He got his name mentioned. Joseph of Arimathea. Let's see what our brother John had to say about him. John, chapter 19. This is gonna hit you. Verse 38. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jews. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with spices and strips of linen. This was in accordance with the Jewish burial custom. They came out of the closet. Joseph and Nicodemus, they finally came out of the closet. Hey, let's lay it out here, guys. Are you a secret disciple? Or you live in a double life? You're Miss Rah-Rah, sing it real loud at church. Oh, bro, I'm doing awesome. But at church, no one knows you're a disciple. Because you're afraid. Kingdom kids suffer from this. One way at church, a double life at school. But it's a temptation to us all. I find it fascinating that the women are at a distance until, verse 55, the women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph. Say what you will about Joseph being a secret disciple, but by golly, at the end of the day, when the chips were down, he let his colors show, and he went to Pilate, and he said, "Give me Jesus' body." I don't know about you, that gets me going. Here are these women standing on the sidelines. They go, "Man, Joseph is getting the body. Let's go help." I mean, it just takes one with enough guts to stand up and say, "This is what I believe." We got secret Christians at work. We got secret Christians in the neighborhoods. We got secret Christians in the school. We got secret Christians in the new movement. People who will not stand up and say, "Listen, this is what I believe. You disfellowship me, I don't care. It's not valid anyway. I believe in Jesus. I'm standing up." And when you take a stand, you know something? There might just be a few others that follow. I told Eddie, I said, "Okay, dude, you ready to give up everything? Amen. Then I need you to really start taking the lead with the teenagers in this church. The Lord's given you a lot of charisma. He's given you a lot of leadership. Time to shake up the kingdom kids in this church." You know, I appreciate Laura this morning. Think about this. Life was hell, and then her mom died. It took that much hand of God on her before she goes, "I need to get back to God." What does God need to do to you before you decide to get restored and take a stand for Jesus Christ? Next week, we'll focus on the last chapter, Luke 24, where it is written in verse 6, "Why do you look for the living amongst the dead? He is not here, he is risen." Everyone we've talked about today is guilty. The Sanhedrin, Pilate, Herod, Simon of Cyrene, the criminals, the centurion, Joseph of Arimathea, the women, Jesus himself. But there's one name we glossed over. Barabbas. The murderer. The insurrectionist. The Osama bin Laden of that day. And Jesus took his place on the cross. Prayerfully, you can parallel your life to one or more of the faces around the cross of the guilty there at Golgotha. But absolutely, you are Barabbas. Jesus died for you. Now, will you live for him? Thank you. God bless.